Hello and welcome to BYJU'S Exam Prep IAS. Let's begin today's daily quiz with question number 1 on your screen. Which of the following best defines Khabar Lahariya? Number 1. The only newspaper in India operated by only Dalit women. 2. NGO working in the Bundelkhand region raising issues of Dalit women. 3. A special provision under the right to information ensuring faster replies to questions submitted by the Dalits. Or 4. A direct benefit transfer scheme for Dalit women in Madhya Pradesh. The correct answer here is A. It is a special newspaper operated in India only exclusively by Dalit women. The reason why it is in the news is because a documentary made on this newspaper story, that is Khabar Lahariya story, has been nominated for the Academy Award, that is the Oscars, in the Best Documentary Feature category. This documentary is known as Writing with Fire. It is directed by Rintu Thomas and Sushmit Ghosh. The newspaper was first started in 2002 in Uttar Pradesh, Bundelkhand region, and continues to challenge popular notions about journalism and the role of women in ensuring that the problems of Dalit women are propagated throughout the community, and each and everyone knows about that. In 2016, the newspaper stopped its publication and pivoted to a digital-only mode. Now it is available on the mobile devices of anyone who wants to read the newspaper. There have been multiple accolades that have been showered on this newspaper since its inception, and this Oscar nomination is in this long line of awards to be given to them. Next, question number 2. Consider the following statements. Number 1. Energy by nuclear fusion promises to be low carbon but more dangerous than how the nuclear energy is now produced. 2. A kilogram of fusion fuel contains about 10 million times as much energy as a kilogram of coal, oil or gas. The ITER is a fusion research mega project supported by 7 members: China, European Union, India, Japan, South Korea, Russia and the US, and it is based in the south of France. Which of these given statements is or are correct? The correct answer here is D. 2 and 3 are correct. The first statement is wrong because a nuclear fusion technology is supposed to be much more safer as compared to the technology that is used today. Today, in most of the nuclear power plants, we use nuclear fission. While countries across the world are trying to master the technology of nuclear fusion, the problem with nuclear fusion is that it produces so much energy that it becomes extremely difficult to control that. And that is why countries across the world, including these 7 nations, have come together in a mega research project to undertake this fusion research. The ITER stands for International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor. The completion of the construction of the main reactor in this joint project is expected to take place by 2025. This will be the largest of more than 100 fusion reactors built around the world. It is based on the tokamak technology that is initiated by Russia. The reason why we are discussing this question is because scientists in the UK have achieved a new milestone in producing nuclear fusion energy. As you know, nuclear fusion is a way in which the sun produces most of its energy. The article says that the team at Joint European Torus facility near Oxford was able to generate 59 megajoules of sustained energy. So it was a small experiment to replicate how large-scale experiments on nuclear fusion can take place. The last record for generating sustained energy for nuclear fusion was created in 1997. The article also tells us that the kilogram of nuclear fuel contains 10 million times as much energy as kilogram of coal, oil or gas. Next, question number 3. INCOIS, that is Indian National Center for Ocean Information Services, operates under which of the following ministries? Ministry of Science and Technology, Ministry of Earth Sciences, Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change, or the Ministry of Defense? The correct answer here is B. This organization works under the Ministry of Earth Sciences. The reason why we are discussing this question is because the INCOIS has carried out a recent coastal vulnerability assessment of the entire Indian coast using a scale of 1:1,000,000 to prepare for Coastal Vulnerability Index. This index, as you would know, helps the government to prepare for dangerous situations that might arise due to sea level increase. As per the study, out of the entire coast of Gujarat, about 124 kilometers of coast is under danger to get affected by rising sea levels. In Maharashtra, about 11 kilometer coast might get affected, while in Karnataka, it is about 48 kilometers. Apart from this, a survey was also conducted in Goa, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Odisha, West Bengal, Lakshadweep Islands, and Andaman and Nicobar Islands. The map takes into consideration the coastal risk not just by increasing sea level but also due to physical changes including tidal range, wave height, the coastal slope, coastal elevation, shoreline change rate, etc. Next, question number 4. Consider the following statements with regards to ASEAN. Number 1. The motto of ASEAN is One Vision, One Identity, One Community. Second, ASEAN was established with the signing of the ASEAN Declaration, also called as Bangkok Declaration, in 1969 by its founding fathers, Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, Singapore, and Thailand. Third, India has a separate mission to ASEAN in Jakarta. Which of these given statements is or are correct? The correct answer here is C. 1 and 3 are correct. The second statement is wrong because the year in which the ASEAN was actually established was 1967. It was established by 5 nations in Southeast Asia. Later on, mainly after the end of the Cold War, other member nations also started to join in. This is said to be one of the most successful regional groupings around the world just after the European Union, and it has made sure that any dispute between any member nation in the ASEAN is resolved peacefully. Most of these are island nations and historically have had boundary related disputes, but none of these have been escalated because of the presence of ASEAN. The reason why we're discussing this question is because India and ASEAN are about to initiate the review of the free trade agreement that exists between the two sides. The two sides have a free trade agreement in goods, which has led to increased trade over the years. The two sides are now seeking to improve market access for domestic products to each other's markets. As you know, the ASEAN initiated the RCEP, which India refused to join at the last stage. Thus, India is hoping to improve its existing free trade agreement with the ASEAN to ensure that we don't miss out on getting market access to these nations. Next, we have a previous year question from 2020. Who among the following rulers advised his subjects through this inscription? Whosoever praises his religious sect or blames other sects out of excessive devotion to his own sect, with the view of glorifying his own sect, he rather injures his own sect very severely. Is it Ashoka, Samudragupt, Harshvardhan, or Krishnadev Rai? The correct answer here is A. Ashoka. Amongst all the Ashokan inscriptions that were left around the country, we have to look at the 12th Rock Edict to understand what this question is talking about. The 12th Rock Edict, amongst the other things, says that the person who praises his religion excessively or condemns other religions will do more harm to his own religion than glorify it. This Rock Edict says that in the world there is place for all the religions to coexist, and it is in the best interest of the mankind that there should be growth of all the religions and not just one. This growth can be in different ways, but you should not try to cut the root of anyone else because it will only damage your own religion and your own beliefs. Next, we have a fact of the day, and we will be discussing about the role of the governor and how the governor plays a dual role when he or she is appointed at the state level. As you know, the role of the governor has been in the news in multiple states for different reasons. There is a governor of West Bengal who was recently blocked by the chief minister of West Bengal on Twitter. There is a Kerala governor who recently passed the ordinance which talked about reducing the powers of the Lokayukta in the state. Then we also have the governor of Tamil Nadu who sent back the need bill to the state legislature of Tamil Nadu. All these things are extremely unusual, and that is why it brings light to the role of the governor today and why is it creating a lot of friction between the state and the center. As you know, the governor in India has to play a dual role. First, the governor is the agent of the central government, and second, the governor is also the constitutional head of the state. However, having said that, the governor only enjoys a few discretionary powers and for most of his functions has to depend on the advice of the Council of Ministers at the state. But since the governor of a state is appointed by the president on the advice of the Central Council of Ministers, they don't take into account the preference of the state government, which has led to a lot of friction between the center and the state. In most of the occasions, you would see that the governors are those people who are retired politicians of the political party who is in the power at the center. And it is alleged that the central government tries to control the state government and its politics through this governor. In the past few years, there have been multiple instances to suggest that the governor is working more in the favor of the central government as compared to the state government. For example, in November 2018, the JNK governor Satyapal Malik dissolved the assembly, even though there were indications that various parties were coming together to form the government. This was the starting of how the central government finally bifurcated the state into two parts and converted it into a union territory. The infamous incident of Maharashtra governor is also unfortunate, in which, despite the other side having the majority, the Maharashtra governor at 6 a.m. in the morning quietly invited the BJP leader Devendra Fadnavis to administer oath to him without even telling anyone. That government only lasted for 80 hours. The governor of Nagaland also recently criticized the affairs of the state and said that the administration is not being carried out properly. There have been multiple such examples that we are seeing throughout the country. One of the reasons is that the appointment of the governor takes place without consulting the state government. There are multiple suggestions given by commissions such as the Sarkaria Commission and also the Panchi Commission, which has suggested that the appointment of the governor should take place only after consulting the state government, but that has not been the case. In fact, the governor's office is increasingly being seen as a retirement home to many politicians from the party that is in the power at the center. Unfortunately, the governors have become political appointees, which was not supposed to be the case. The CM is answerable to the people, but the governor is answerable to no one but the center government. And that is why the governor usually is seen as being biased towards the central government by many states. The other side of the coin is that if a governor does not want to follow the directions given by the center government, many of these governors are removed without their completion of the tenure or are transferred frequently from one state to the other. Thus, the only way forward is for all the political parties to come together, accept the recommendations given by the Sarkaria Commission, the Panchi Commission, and National Commission to review the working of the Constitution, and ensure that in the interest of a strong federal country, the governor's office is protected. This is it for today's video. Thank you so much for watching.